I often use this analogy to cooking. You want to get a certain texture and a certain taste. And in case of metals production, it's the same thing. You add a little bit of iron and a little bit of manganese and a little bit of titanium and maybe a little bit of carbon to get a set of properties that you want. Fatigue resistance, failure resistance, strength and ductility, informability and so forth. In our lab, there's a specific focus on what we call healing or self-healing of metals. We use steels in aluminium alloys, in titanium alloys, in cars, in constructions, in planes, even in our bodies, so we use implants. We want lighter cars, but at the same time we want cars that are safer. We want planes that have longer lifetimes and that can carry more people in a single run. But on top of it, there are also environmental challenges, and this is one of the things that we, in my group, focus on. If we want to cut down carbon dioxide emissions, we cannot rely solely on processing solutions. We have to also rely on material solutions. In other words, we have to find ways of using less metals, and we have to find ways of using metals that go for a longer time. And sort of an extreme example that I like is Mars expedition, for instance. Think about the days when this is possible. We won't be able to carry tons of steel from Earth to Mars. And there also, this kind of healing or resetting concepts would be very critical. Once we produce these alloys that we designed based on our healing or resetting concepts, we of course want to characterize these materials. Then we have a better understanding of how we can manipulate these microstructures. And it's normal. In a traditional lab, you use relatively larger rigs and carry out experiments. Then you look at the microstructure. We here in my lab follow a different approach, and we use what is called in situ techniques, so that we gather information about both the mechanical response and information about the microstructural response at the same time, so that we can connect these dots. And to be able to do this, we constantly come up with new techniques for our electron microscope. For example, most of the materials that we design have nanostructures, so very small structures. And the individual properties of the structures, they are important. So how do you test these individual properties? You do this by getting a tiny probe and being able to do in situ small-scale indentation experiments. It's like taking a tiny pin and sort of pinching different phases and look at how hard they are and how stiff they are. When we are shaping metals for different processes, for example, you just produce a sheet metal and you want to use it to make the body of a car. The way the metal deforms locally is very different than just the normal uniaxial tension test that we typically do in the lab to characterize its behavior. So locally, parts of the metal is being stretched in both directions, parts of the metal are stretched only in one direction, and parts of the metal are bent. So typically, in metallurgical labs, these strain path effects are not so much investigated. So what we do is we carry out what is called bulge tests. You take a thin sheet of metal, so this is a typical sample, and this is very thin, and you clamp it in such a way that you can apply pressure from the bottom and bulge it. This is quite an interesting technique because it allows us to stop the experiment at any given time, take the sample out and bring it back again to our electron microscope. Because remember, one of our main focuses is being able to do things in situ, being able to track how microstructures evolve under complex boundary conditions. We want to understand the orientation dependence of damage resistance. And we do this by milling out, micro-milling, a shape like a flower, like a star. And then we put cyclic loads on this material. So the direction in which the material is most sensitive to the cracking, we would see that the crack would nucleate and propagate. And once the crack starts propagating, then we can look at the interaction of this crack with the surrounding microstructure. If we look at our own lives, I see that more and more we lose this capability to reuse things. I know from my own family that my father is much more capable of repairing things than myself. And I know from his stories that his father was. So from a more social perspective, we lose this capability of repair and reuse more and more. And thus, I think it's very important for us scientists to show that this is still both scientifically interesting and, you know, engineering-wise, it's also feasible and logical.
You guys into trying the things.